trigger this. Okay, so thoughts on that? Where did your conversations take you to with that? Breakfast. Go for it, Ryan. Feel free to jump in.
Yeah, sure. We touched on almost straight away about economic factors in terms of making choices in part based on your financial circumstances, and then oddly you talked about on a more like relating to globalism, futures market for popular breakfast items, and how that reflected monoculture in the US. Mm-hmm. And then somewhat about the diversification of Australian breakfast options as a burgeoning kind of multi-ethnicity, multicultural community, and I think we all welcome that.
Others, thanks, Ryan. I mean, yes, I think that helps illustrate all sorts of things, doesn't it? I mean, I will jump in on this one because I think it's actually interesting. Milk is kind of fascinating from that point of view. When I was a kid, we used to get free milk at school. I couldn't believe it when I came to Australia because it used to be sitting outside for at least an hour before we got to it. So it was as warm as by the time we got to it on a September day. It was strange stuff. But the ways in which milk has become, it's got a kind of national feel to it. And the kinds of subsidies that happened and the kinds of promotions that happened around it, the shaping of a nation in that way, I think are fascinating. I mean, it was also available to me in the UK as well. Anyway. Others.
I just want to quickly jump. Sorry. Go. I just want to quickly jump into what you said there, Martin, because I actually watched this very interesting YouTube video on how the US has basically structured the food pyramid around, like, during that time where they were heavily subsidizing milk, because a lot of milk farmers were literally dumping milk out because they couldn't sell it. And then tying that to with our conversation with our group, we actually talked about how breakfast. How even governments recognize that breakfast is the most important part of the meal of the day. Like they say, like even as a child, we were taught you should always eat breakfast, lunch, and dinner to be healthy, sort of thing. And I think businesses also capitalize on that by selling us goods such as, cereal and bread, eggs, and all that stuff. And I think Rebecca, she lives at one of the colleges, and even she said that during her, her meal rotation throughout the day, they literally stopped serving them like toast and stuff, because we recognize that is as being like a breakfast part of, part of our breakfast routine. Yes. So I found that thing.
Yes. Yes. Cultured. Sienna, I think you're trying to contribute here.
Is breakfast a wholly universal concept? Because I also there were books about it and such growing up about how you have to eat breakfast every time. And I've never liked breakfast, and so I typically don't eat it, and I haven't died yet. So I just wonder, is that a universal concept to think that breakfast is so important?
Anybody got any thoughts on that? It is in my world. I've never looked at it, Sienna. Great question. Anybody got any
brunch.
Thoughts on?
Brunch is pretty good.
Brunch is pretty good. Sure, Alfie, but the question is, does it seem like breakfast is a universal experience? I suppose in places where there's not much food, there's some interesting questions, where there is food scarcity, it becomes an interesting question about what becomes the most important. Perhaps it's any meal. But look, I don't know. Any other thoughts on that?
I've traveled a bit around the place and around the world, and my experience is that breakfast is pretty much universal if people have food. Mm-hmm. What's not necessarily universal is dinner. Places that I've been, like Burma or Mongolia and stuff, it's two meals a day being breakfast and lunch. And that kind of thing. But it's also, we also talked about, and I remembered sort of 10 years ago, I was property manager in a retreat and study center down south, and I had to have breakfast with strangers every day, with people that I didn't know or didn't like, and the options weren't necessarily things that were good for my health. And as I'm lactose and sugar intolerant and stuff like that. So when I left that community, I still, 11 years later, every morning, wake up with such relief that I do not have to speak to other people. Or, I mean, I don't even really eat breakfast. I'm pretty random about what I eat and when I eat it, but yeah.
But yeah, there you were in a very structured environment.
Yeah, the culture around breakfast and what expectations that other people have, and then kind of impose that on others.
Yep.
Yeah.
Mm. Interesting. Thank you. Anybody else got anything? Yes, go for it, Rod.
Yeah, our group, we were talking about, well, this might be a little bit out there, but my breakfast experience with my children, because, well, my ancestry is in the Caribbean, right? And I'd use this example of cornmeal porridge or polenta, as they call it in Spain. Now polenta, they'll have it as an accompaniment for something with dinner, but in the Caribbean it's more of a staple kind of breakfast meal, like a porridge, right? So for me, when we when the kids were young, I would sort of try and encourage them to have a little bit of polenta, right, just to, for me, to pass on that link, that cultural link between my, our ancestry and them through food. Now, I know that this polenta is, you can't, it comes probably from Queensland or something like that. And there's no link with the Caribbean, in a physical sense. But for me, there is this cultural thing. That is what brings me back to my childhood. We had polenta and breakfast in the morning. I have no agency for where this thing comes from, but sociologically it just does feel like there's it's a way of maintaining a link through distance.
So there's a good example, Rod, of Greg Attioli's insight about breakfast is where serious identity work can happen.
Absolutely, yeah, and it does. I the kids don't care what they'll eat it. They don't see it through the same lens as I do, but for me, it's a important link that maybe they might realize later on, 20 years down the line. Highly unlikely, but
Rod. We spoke about porridge as well, both Eastern and Western kind of forms. Yes, is it possible that the most universal form of breakfast is a boiled grain or legume?
Mm.
I believe so. Through probably, there's in the cultural sector, people don't have that much money, and that's what's accessible to people.
So, certainly in agricultural societies, it'd be interesting to look at it. It would make sense, wouldn't it?
And also just to add tack onto the end of that, just the through biosecurity, what is available in Australia. When you move here, one of the things is that you don't have a lot of spices or things that, to be able to maintain a cultural link with, food wise. So anyway, there you go. That's my rant.
Right. Good. Thanks, Rod. Very interesting. And you can see how you could actually write quite eloquently around this theme about and what it would allow us to pick up in terms of culture choices, all those sorts of things, for sure. And I mean, the other thing that's worth looking at is the ways in which in the Western world, in the Anglophone world, Protestant capitalists, started groups like Sanitarium. They started most of the cereal companies that produce the stuff that goes onto table. So it's an industrial revolution food as well. Much of the ways in which cereal is now processed into its boxes and packets and so on. So that's another part of a kind of continuity we've got. And now, of course, we've got, I would put it down to an individualizing time now, where we're actually all wanting to have that sense of choice. It's a very perhaps affluent middle class kind of approach to where things are, but superfoods are fascinating, of course, from that point of view as well, and what's going on with that. And as I think somebody said, the ways in which government has you know, and the messages we get about breakfast being the most important meal of the day, which Sienna, of course, you reject totally, and here you are still feeling in the flush of health, I'm sure. But yeah, I mean, it's very, very interesting. Of course, we've got research now talking about intermittent fasting and what that can do for us. But it is really kind of fascinating just to unpick and unpack all those different things. And I'm pretty sure if I was ever to get around to it, I could write an autoethnography about my breakfast choices and how I've moved into the particular choice I've made, which has probably been with me for about 10 years now, which are about health messages. It's about the kind of stuff I grew up on that's influenced and impacted on me. And it is about choices that I've made along the way as well. But they're never those kind of, it is a form of agency. But let me come to that now. Let me just share a couple of things. So this will become about a 10-minute sort of mini lecture, but please feel free to interject. Please do that if you care to. I just want to talk about the sociological concept of agency, and hopefully this has been a useful precursor for that. So something I've written about is that culture-structured agency is part of our every living moment. And that's sometimes hard. I think sometimes there's a view of agency as being much more dramatic than that. That's when I really make free choice, a point that was highlighted a bit earlier as well. Alfie, I think, brought that up, maybe because of having read some of the stuff I've put here. But structuration is a term that you may or may not have come across. It's from Anthony Giddens, Lord Giddens, as he is these days, a sociologist who's really made it into the elite. Giddens attempts to transcend traditional division in sociology between action and structure by focusing on social practices, which he argues produce and are produced by structures. So basically, he's saying the two need to be held in dynamic tension, structure and agency. Now, it's an anthropological lens that tends to bring culture into play, which is, I think, useful in the triangular model that I've already shared with you. Bourdieu has the notion of practice, which is quite similar to Giddens, although what Bourdieu is very focused on is how does it become embodied? How do structures become part of us? How do we become part of our bodily practice? That's through the notion of habitus. So a practice approach or perspective, I actually find the notion of it being a theory not very helpful. I think it is an approach or a perspective on the world. Have you also got Bourgeois, who some of you may have read last semester, some of those who were in first semester this year, you will have read In Search of Respect by Bourgeois, and he refers to cultural production theory, which is very, very similar, holding in dynamic tension these realities. I want to just then reflect briefly on Growing Corn in Chiapas. Some of you may have read this, some of you may not at this point. But part of what I want to just talk about is, you know, we can think about breakfast again in the Mexican sense. You know, Mexican breakfast is pretty famous, I believe. And the rancheros. So just making a quick reference to that. But just thinking about corn, and this is perhaps getting to some of the points that Rod was making and Rowan as well about, you know, some sort of legume or some sort of grain being significant. Sown to be eaten. This is coming out of the Galemba paper. It's the sacred sustenance of the men who were made of maize. Sown to make money, it means famine for the men who were made of maize. That's, you know, an interesting thing to reflect upon. What happens when you commodify the materials that was the sacred sustenance of life? I lived in Papua New Guinea for 2.5 years. I think I've said that a couple of times now. One of the first times I really spoke Tok Pisin was in the highlands, and I had just eaten my third sweet potato. As I visited one house to the next, my mouth is collapsing under it. But one of the young men I was hanging out with at that time turned to me and he said very, very earnestly, Martin, kaukau e mi bun belong me. Sweet potato is my bone. And it, you know, and I mean, what a beautiful, beautiful way to put it. You know, the ways in which it's so much a part of me and my strength and my comfort, I think, is part of what he was saying. Another point coming out of this particular article from Galemba, as Roberto Rossellini de Macaros, the Union of Corn Producers, asked in King's Study. If we in Mexico do not have a comparative advantage in the production of maize, then what exactly do we have a comparative advantage in? Now, what that is a reference to, you may, those of you who've read it will have picked up that the free trade agreement gets struck between the US and Mexico. And what's one of the first things that happens? Cheap corn from the US gets dumped in Mexico, undercutting the market there. That's where that response comes from. How the hell does that happen? Are interesting questions to ask of this world in which we live. Guillermo makes the point that being critical to examine neoliberalism in its ethnographic context and to suggest and to tease out the changing relations of power, economic sense, and morality that are going on in there. And I'd suggest to you that it is useful to think about this through a lens of culture, structure, agency, the practice approach to this. What does this do to practice? So explaining the moves to cross-border corn trading in Chiapas, which is what Galembo is doing, we see two main groups, borderland farmers and merchants. And just reading around this particular triangle, what I'm suggesting here is that the individual, the self, or collectives are caught, are in this dynamic tension, but it's not caught in a web or a net or anything like that. It's a dynamic tension that I think is governs our lives in all sorts of different ways. So at first glance, what actually this paper is about, for those who haven't read it yet, is about a group of people who find themselves in a position, they're corn farmers, they find themselves in the position where the market's been undercut by trade agreements, and they are not getting the money they used to get because of neoliberal movements towards privatization. So the cooperative that they once had that guaranteed corn prices for them is gone. That was part of the agreement that gets struck. So they no longer got a guaranteed price. So what happens to the price is continues to go down below the rates that are sustainable for them. So what they then do is open up markets, illegal or tolerated officially, but really not legal, across the border into Guatemala, which they border onto. So they get a better price for corn in Guatemala for their corn there. And they use the free trade notion to say, but this is a free trade. You know, this is what we're entitled to do. It's not part of the agreement, but this is unofficial and an interesting appropriation of the term itself. So at first glance, the corn trade could be interpreted as a form of resistance, of real agency, as some may want to picture this, to the liberalization of the Mexican and Guatemalan economies and the exclusion of peasants, a more peasant type of production that preceded this, or socialist, some may want to call it. But what Galembo points us to is that the residents' practices do not necessarily contest free trade and exclusionary state policies. That's not what's going on. They reconfigure relations with the neoliberal economy and the state in complex and often contradictory ways, the use of free trade being quite an example of it. And what I just want to put to you here is, in understanding the everydayness of this, an everydayness of, you know, I mean, that's what we're talking about for most of our social lives, aren't they? Most times, but of course, when I say everydayness, this is everydayness of actually making money. So it is, it's bigger than that, and actually being able to feed yourself and your family. But what we're doing most of the time is considering how people get by and make do. They're not necessarily trying to resist the system, they're trying to work within it in some way or another. They're the kinds of choices that people have until it becomes impossible to do, I think that. I think that's perhaps one of the realities of what goes on here. So just looking very, very briefly here, explaining the moves to cross-border corn trading in Chiapas, borderland farmers and merchants. Let's look at it from the borderland farmer perspective. If we think here about some of the structural issues that they're being faced with, just over here, poverty, the history of borderland life, especially trade, the economic liberalization and what that has brought, the NAFTA free trade agreement, the removal of the national body guaranteeing the price of corn that I talked about before, continued ownership, connection to land. Also in the background, this is one of the areas where the Zapatista rebellion hasn't taken hold, but there's real possibilities of that as people become, you know, if people become more and more impoverished, more and their livelihoods are more and more threatened. There's also the drug cartels of Mexico that are creating their own forms of havoc and chaos around the place as they draw people in. And what what the officials in the areas are trying to do is keep them out of the rebellion, to keep them out of the cartel regions, so that then informal agreements get struck with local officials, allowing this illicit trade to happen in corn. And then that gets, they start to appropriate is a self-governing discourse of neoliberalism. This is free trade. This is commitment to autonomy and free trade that the locals take on in order to justify what they're doing, or to actually enable what they're doing is perhaps another way of seeing this. So the residents' practices, now if I go up here to the cultural elements, the centrality of corn farming to lived experience, bon blanc mi in the PNG term, the history of borderland life, peasant farmer mode of production for centuries, but that's now being changed. But the continuities are important to recognize in change as well. The family life, the upbringing, and what that means and how that impacts what how people see the world. The official tolerance of illicit trade, I'd suggest, is actually a cultural thing as well as structural. And it's hard to separate these out sometimes. And then we get, yeah, the self-governing discourse of neoliberalism becomes part of the cultural patterns that people absorb and take on, that commitment to autonomy and free trade. So residents' practices in terms of agency do not necessarily contest free trade and exclusionary state policies. Rather, they configure relations with the neoliberal economy and the state in complex and often contradictory ways. That is what I believe is a sociologically orthodox way of starting to think about how people express agency or enact their lives. The merchants, well, look, you can see here, I'm just picking up some of the differences. One of the differences for the merchants is that they are becoming owners of the means of production. They own the trucks. And in owning the trucks, and their capital coming from their continued ownership of land and cattle, and also significant for this group are remittances from the USA. So from the people who are going to the USA and working the farms there, low-income earners there, but still able to send back what is significant amounts of money through remittance. There was a great program on Radio National on the weekend about remittance in Australia, and I probably will highlight this a bit later on in the unit. But the significance of remittances is important to understand in terms of the finance scape that's part of our global realities. So this is one of the differences between the merchants, but they still grow up in this within this history, this historical setting, borderland life. Family life, capitalist mode of production is more evident amongst this group. They were broken away from the peasant existence, or that relationship on patrons in some way becoming a more capitalist in their movements and actions. Official tolerance of the illicit trade and so on. So there's a lot of overlapping things going on in all of that. So I'm just trying to give a setting and just give you a sense of ways of thinking about this paper, just in terms of, and I think some of the ways in which Galemba is pushing us to think about what's going on here, the complexities that are so much a part of all of our lives, and to suggest to you to think about cultured, structured agency as a very productive way of thinking about how all of us make do and get by in our own different ways. And of course, that's going to be dependent very much on our own economic means in that regard. Coming up, quiz one, that's going to open up on Wednesday and we'll close on Friday, 6 p.m. I always hope that's going to work. I think the settings are right, but I'm no doubt I'll hear from people if it's not, but it looks to be okay. There'll be 15 questions for that. The tutorials, we're going to preparing to debate fair trade, the notion of fair trade being a waste of time and energy, and seeing what you make of that. Encouraging you to start planning your essay, choosing which one you're going to do. And next week's workshop will focus on the notions of homogenization, heterogenization, and hybridity. We'll also give a little bit of focus to the employability award and careers and ways in which doing a BA can be productive for you in that regard. Hopefully, it'll still be able to do a BA with anthropology and sociology. I don't know what today's meeting is going to throw up for us. Okay, let me stop the share. Any questions, observations, thoughts?
Is Ron? The quiz this week covering this week's material as well?
One, two, three, yeah.
One, two, three. Yep.
Yeah.
But this is four then, so it's not covering this week.
Modules 1, 2, and 3, Rowan. Modules 1, 2.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So sorry about that. Yeah, the confusion's there. Any other thoughts, questions, insights? Okay, folks. Good luck with it. I'll see you in Tutes tomorrow. Look forward to that.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you. Bye now.